I will live in the house of the Lord forever. Live in the house of the Lord forever. Live in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Good evening, everyone, at Praise Chapel Revival Oxnard. This is Pastor Johnny Montillo, welcoming you to our Wednesday midweek service. I hope and I pray that tonight's message encourage, inspire, motivate, and most importantly, that you apply every kingdom principle of tonight's message into your daily walk with Jesus Christ. As always, I just want to thank the shepherd of our church, Pastor Mondo Carrillo, and his wife, Sister Veronica Carrillo, for all that they do for the body of Christ. Continue to keep them and the entire body of Christ in your daily prayers always. And in speaking of prayer, let us just open up in a word of prayer before we dive into tonight's message. Father God, we thank you, Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father God, for your word. We thank you, Father God, for your guidance. We thank you, Lord, for all that you do for us, Father God. We praise your holy name, Father God. And as we enter into your word tonight, I pray that hearts be open and that spirits be receptive to the message that is being brought forth tonight. Let it transform individuals. Let it encourage individuals. Let it motivate individuals. Let those in attendance tonight who feel dejected and feel defeated, let them be inspired and encouraged to press forward, Father God. Holy Spirit, we yield tonight's service to you, and we know and await with expectation that mighty things are going to be done because your word, Father God, is being spoken. We thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, and as always, we are careful to give you all the honor and the praise and the glory. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. And keeping up with the parables of Jesus Christ, tonight we're going to go into the parable of the great banquet, which resides in Luke chapter 14. We're going to explore this parable, if you will, with the understanding and the importance and the aim to understand the invite of Jesus Christ. The parable of the great banquet tells us much about the kingdom. It tells us much about God's grace. It tells us about the mission of Christ, but it also reveals the consequences of rejecting the invite to salvation through the gospel. This parable, the parable of the great banquet, occurs as Christ was on his way to Jerusalem, and it finds itself in the midst of other parables concerning discipleship and even kingdom ethics. And it occurs immediately after Jesus heals a man on the Sabbath and is questioned by the Pharisees. Jesus aimed this parable towards the Pharisees, if you will. And Jesus Christ tells a parable even before the parable of the great banquet, aimed towards the Pharisees, which he tells them that if they hold a luncheon, if they hold a banquet, that they should not invite the rich and the prominent, but they should invite the crippled, the poor, the lame, and the blind. Perhaps this statement must have left the Pharisees stunned because it wasn't customary to do those things. But the silence would be broken with a declaration from a man in the crowd, and this would lead to the parable altogether. Turn your Bibles, if you will, to Luke chapter 14, verse 15. It says, when one of those at the table with him heard this, he said to Jesus, "Blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God." As we stated, this parable that we're about to go into, the parable of the banquet, occurs after Christ had healed a man and after Christ had aimed another parable towards the Pharisees altogether. And the parable that was aimed at the Pharisees concerned a banquet and concerned a luncheon. And you have this man who probably filled with jubilation just declares, "Blessed is the one who will eat and feast in the kingdom of God." Perhaps the man was overjoyed and it caused him to declare this blessing. Whatever the case, this declaration by this man sets up a parable. And it sets up a parable that would show us the great wisdom and blessed knowledge of Christ in action, and would lead directly to the parable of the great banquet. As we continue on in Luke chapter 14, verses 16 through 17, it says, Jesus replied in response to that man, "A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. And at the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, 'Come, for everything is now ready.'" You see, the kingdom is prepared and the invite has already been extended. A banquet during the time of Christ was a huge deal. It was a big deal, both in the physical and the scriptural aspects to the Jewish. Throughout the Old Testament, especially in the book of Isaiah, chapter 25, verse 6, if you have an opportunity, go there later on, we can read that a great banquet will be prepared for all the people of the world by the Lord. And the Jews in attendance would know this scripture, and they would know this imagery, if you will. So the parable opens up with a host, a certain man sending out invitations well in advance to the banquet itself. And we can gather that that host that is being spoken about is God. And the many invited guests Jesus Christ was talking about, first and foremost in this parable, was the Jew. As God's chosen people, they had been invited to the kingdom first and foremost. The invitation to the Jew had come in many forms, through revelation of the Lord, through prophets, and even through scriptures. And they had been waiting for the Messiah, and Christ was right there. And through the opening of the parable, Christ was saying to them that the kingdom is prepared, that the Messiah was there, in their midst, right then and there. Yet many there did not embrace that declaration or embrace that truth. The servants Christ spoke about were the prophets and he himself, who were sent to tell them that everything was ready for the banquet. Everything was ready for the kingdom. The opening of the parable should also speak to us also, as we have also been invited. And we too know that Christ was sent to prepare the kingdom on our behalf also. So Christ opens up this parable of the banquet by describing the invite to a great banquet. And who wouldn't want to attend that type of celebration? But the invite, though it was extended, it wasn't met with a jubilant RSVP, but rather some excuses. As we continue on in Luke chapter 14, verses 18 through 20. It says, but they all begin to make excuses. The first said, I have just bought a field and I must go and see it. Please excuse me. Another said, I have just bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm on my way to try them out. Please excuse me. Still another said, I just got married, so I cannot come. Lots of excuses for not RSVPing. And in fact, these aren't excuses, but they're insults, if you will. Has the servant extended the invite and stated that all had been prepared? And think of that just for a second, that all was prepared. Those invited, those three groups invited right there, they didn't need to bring anything or do anything. They just had to show up. They didn't need to bring a dish. They didn't need to bring anything at all. They just had to show up. And it's Christ explaining grace in action, because we don't need to bring anything at all. All we need to bring to Christ is ourselves. But there's nothing that we can bring to make our way to the kingdom. It's only by grace. It's grace in action that Christ is describing through this, yet it was met with excuses. Now let's break down those three excuses for a minute, because as we will find, they're really not excuses, but rather lies and insults. The first one said, I bought a field and I must go see it. Now that was a blatant lie. For who would purchase something, especially land, without first surveying it, without first seeing it, without seeing if it was useful for building on or even yielding crops? That was important during that time. The next one said, I've just bought oxen and must test them. You see, in the time of Christ, oxen were critical in ensuring that the land plowed was properly plowed. And in fact, oxen were bought and tested with the current oxen you may have. See, landowners would buy more oxen and test those oxen against the other oxen to ensure that the land that was being plowed in unison, that there was almost like a team dynamic in regards to the oxen. See, no one would buy oxen, especially 5 yoke of oxen, without first doing this. It would be like buying a tractor without first seeing if it worked or if the engine turned on. So this was a blatant lie, not an excuse. And the last guest says, I can't come. I just got married. Now, on the surface, this may seem like a valid excuse for not attending. But think about this just for a minute. Weddings in those days were never planned on the same day as other events. A wedding and a banquet would not be planned on the same day, because villages themselves were small. And they would plan just things on single days, a single thing on just one day. So that way the whole village could attend in mass community. In fact, weddings and celebrations would last days and sometimes weeks. So to say that he could not come because he just got married was a blatant lie. It was a blatant lie. No excuse altogether. On the surface, this one might seem like, yeah, I can understand that. But this itself was a blatant lie and an excuse that held no weight. What it comes down to is that there is no excuse for failing to RSVP to the kingdom. or rather no excuse for not responding to the invitation to the banquet, to the kingdom, to salvation. Yet there are still excuses that exist even today. Some people will say, I'm not ready to respond to Jesus Christ yet, or I don't want to change my lifestyle, or I didn't get the invite, or I don't have time for church or to hear the word of God. Those aren't excuses. Those are just blatant insults in response to the kingdom invite. Whatever the case, this was Christ saying that there are a lot of excuses for not RSVPing to the kingdom, but each one is an insult to God. Each one doesn't hold any weight. Each one is not valid. There are no excuses for not RSVPing to the great banquet, to the kingdom of God, to salvation. No excuses, only blatant rejection and disregard. The truth is, though, excuses may be plenty, but there is no excuse for not attending that grace-filled kingdom invite. And when there are excuses made, the banquet doesn't shut down, but the invitations decline make way for invites to be extended elsewhere, leaving those who declined altogether out of the banquet altogether, as we'll see in Luke chapter 21, verse 24. It says, a servant came back and reported this to the master. Then the owner of the house became angry and ordered his servant, go out quickly into the streets and the alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. Sir, the servant said, what you have ordered has been done, but there is still room. Then the master told his servant, go to the roads and the country lanes and compel them to come in so that my house will be full. I tell you that not one of those who were invited will get a taste of my banquet. You see, when there's a rejection, when there's a declining, if you will, to RSVPing to that great banquet of salvation, it doesn't stop. But now the invite becomes extended to all. When the servant came back and told the host about the excuses, he was furious. And who wouldn't be angry? He had prepared a feast. He had made all the arrangements. And all those initially invited, all they had to do was show up and be served. But they all made excuses. That would make anybody angry. That would make anybody furious. And the owner told the servant to go out to the streets and the alleys to get what would be considered the outcast of Israel during that time. The people he told to go get would be considered the outcast of Israel. He was told to bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. Now, this is significant because during that time, the poor often didn't attend banquets. They weren't invited to banquets. The poor were hardly invited. And crippled people, sadly, were left unmarried due to their condition or their ailment that they were going through. And the blind themselves couldn't view fields or purchase oxen because of their ailment, because they were blind. What Christ is saying is to invite those who would have no insulting excuse, who would have no excuse, but rather those who would humbly and exuberantly respond with a resounding yes to an invite that they never even expected to receive, that they know that they only received by grace. Now, isn't that the proper kingdom response? To respond in humbleness, to respond exuberantly, to respond, if you will, to that invite, knowing that it was only by grace. That's who the servant was told to get when these others made excuses. You and I have been poor in spirit. You and I have been crippled in spirit at times. You and I have even been blind to what we were doing. But yet, by grace, we were given that invite to that great banquet, the kingdom of God. By grace, through Jesus Christ, we were given that invite when others rejected. And that's how our response should be. It should be a response that doesn't feel entitled, but rather knows that grace has invited you, that grace has extended to you. And how will you and I respond? After the cripple, the poor, the lame, and the blind had been invited, there was still room left. So the servant was asked to go to the country roads and lanes to compel more to come so that the house would be full. That term compel means to urge. It means to adamantly, if you will, invite. Adamantly invite. This second invitation that we just talked about no doubt alludes to the promise and the invite that we too as Gentiles would also receive. In this sense, Christ was saying that the chosen people, the Jews, many of them would have excuses for not answering the invite that was made by Christ. And through Christ, the invite now was for all people, you and I. No one's excluded. We are all invited. But what it comes down to is the response. What it comes down to is when you have that invitation, are you going to RSVP? When you have that invitation, are you going to respond? If you have that invitation, are you going to know that you cannot bring nothing there? It is only by grace that that invitation is extended and that attendance of the kingdom is made. Perhaps the most important and even most chilling statement of the parable occurs in its end. As Jesus says, that not one of those who was initially invited and made an excuse will get a taste of the banquet at all. It was a warning that those who would reject Christ or come up with insulting reasons for rejecting him will not get into the kingdom at all. Pretty shocking. Pretty shocking. Point being that those who receive the invite yet reject and therefore are excluded have only themselves to blame. You see, you and I have gotten that invite. And it came in the form of Jesus Christ. We've gotten that invite into the kingdom, and it came in the form of a sacrifice on the cross. We have that invitation, yet we will respond accordingly to what Christ has given us. By grace, we have that invitation. It makes me think often. Oftentimes, we've been invited to birthday parties, you and I. And those invitations, we put them on our refrigerator. And next thing you know, a year goes by or some time goes by and you still have that invite to that party, but you didn't attend. It's there, but you never went. You missed the opportunity. And it's the same way that Jesus was saying when it comes to the kingdom. That we can miss that opportunity if we fail to respond, if we fail to RSVP. You and I have been extended a great invitation into the kingdom by grace, through grace, to come fully into the kingdom. Let us not make excuses anymore for not diving all the way into the things of the Lord, all the way into immersing ourselves in the things of God, because the invitation has been given to us. And understand this. It's been prepared. All things have been prepared. We don't have to bring anything to this great banquet. It's been set and prepared for us by grace. Now, once again, will you RSVP or will you make excuses and not get a taste of the banquet at all? Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your holy word, Father God. We thank you for this parable, Father God. That reminds us, Lord Jesus Christ, of the invite you've extended to us, of the grace that you've given towards us, and how we should respond, Father God. Let us not come up with excuses for not diving all the way into the things of you, Lord Jesus Christ. Let us immerse ourselves, Father God, in the things of you. And Father God, let us RSVP to that great banquet, that great kingdom that you have prepared for all of us. And for those that we know who have rejected you, Father God, we pray. We pray, Father God, that you remind them that to reject means to be left out. To reject means that they will not receive the kingdom at all. Let us remind those and let us urge those or even compel those who are dealing with that to come back to you or to even come towards you initially, Father God. We thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, because your word is mighty, powerful, and wonderful. We love you, Lord. We thank you for the grace that's been given. And Father God, we adamantly, exuberantly, jubilantly, if you will, respond in a resounding yes to your invite. We thank you, Lord. We love you, and we pray in your most holy name, the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen. And tonight's altar moment, I believe it's a time for us to answer that invite, to understand that it's by grace, to stop thinking that it's by what we do, but rather it's by grace. Understand that it's already been prepared. How wonderful is that for each and every one of us? To know that the kingdom's been prepared for each and every one of us. Even in this altar moment, it is a time to thank the Lord for all that he's done. To thank the Lord for that invite. To thank the Lord for allowing us access to the banquet, access to the kingdom. And it's only by grace and grace alone. Let us not reject that invitation, but let us dive deep in it and let us accept it and let us RSVP, because there's no excuses. There are no excuses for not answering that invite. Let us pray.
Take the scales off of my eyes, 'cause I want.